Next, we come to a story that's actually a connection between various stories, in fact. It's something that we saw on the horizon that we flagged quite literally last month. And this is the ongoing economic fallout from 2020, the year that it's been, for museums and art galleries and entertainment and other related spaces. And it's really crystallized in the form of this particular headline that came to my attention on the 20th of September, and that is that the Royal Academy faces a cruel dilemma, says the Guardian, and that is whether to sell a Michelangelo statue or lose, or rather, I suppose, cut 150 positions, 150 jobs in the organisation. This is paired also in the Guardian this month with news on the 4th of October, but we're slipping it in because it's okay. Royal Opera House to sell off David Hockney painting in bid to stay afloat, and also actually a link that you brought to my attention as well. Once again, all these links are below as ever. The Washington Post here saying that this is how bad things are for museums. They now have the green light to sell off their art. What can we say about this other than that it's a very difficult balance, I suppose, in so much as the. So I've seen some people making the argument that an organisation like the Royal Academy has a longevity and a projected future that will survive whatever economic situation they're currently in, and therefore they can probably afford to maybe long-term lease or medium-term lease out a piece of art in order to try and preserve jobs in the within the building. But that's not necessarily the case, though, is it? It's a complicated matter when it comes to rights and ownership of material in these spaces. What's your take on this? Because I don't envy anyone having to walk this path.
No, it's very complicated. And the rule of thumb in the museum world is that once an object is part of a public collection, it's deemed to be part of that collection in perpetuity because the idea is to prevent a rogue director, for example, selling off a valuable work of art and pocketing the cash, put it its crudest. It's dressed up as, once something is in the public domain, it should remain in the public domain. Deaccessioning is surrounded by very complex rules. And in fact, if you contravene those rules, the consequences can be quite severe. For example, the most recent case in the UK was a case of Second Car in Northampton, where a clique at the top of Northampton Borough Council decided to sell off this Egyptian statue that had been gifted to the Borough Museum in the late 19th century by the Marquess of Northampton, who probably legally still owned it. The legal advice was never made public. But a deal was cooked up between the current Marquess and the museum whereby the proceeds of the sale were split. It was sold at Christie's for much more than the reserve. I think it was something like £15.7 million to a private collector. It's never been seen since. The only all we know is that it was exported to the United States. Where it went after that, we just do not know. And as a result of that, Northampton Council were expelled from the Museums Association, and which meant, for example, that they wouldn't be eligible for Arts Council funding for 5 years.
5 years.
Yes.
Okay. And when did this
It's like
happen?
a they're coming to the end of their step their stretch now.
Okay.
And it turned out that the Marquess got 6 million quid, having all the sale proceeds and taxes and so on paid by the council. He promptly gifted £1 million of it back to local charities, he said. There were accusations at the time, and these are only allegations, of course, that the deal stitched up was, for example, very tax efficient for the Marquess, given the number of marriages that he's having to pay off.
Okay, interesting. So there are related issues, shall we say, to this quandary.
This is why there are very strict rules around the accessioning artifact. Now the thing is, now like you're saying, with the Royal Opera House and their Hockney, the Royal Opera House is not an art gallery. No. It does not hold works of art in the public interest. Like, for example, the British Museum is not allowed to deaccession artifacts by Act of Parliament. That's what all the argument about the Parthenon marbles centres around. Mm. The BM says, for example, it can't give them back to Greece even if it wants to, unless the law's changed. But in the case of the Royal Opera House, it's there to produce opera. Mm. And the fact that they have a painting of their former chair by David Hockney is an accident of history and art fashion at the time when the portrait was commissioned. And therefore, they could actually sell on the item in order to deal with an immediate cash flow issue. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, you could say, well, okay, a National Trust value house that's facing a deficit because of loss of COVID footfall, could the National Trust then sell the Gainsborough that hangs in the drawing room for the same reason? Mm. You see how complicated this is getting.
Yeah.
It's a judgment of Solomon, and this isn't just in this country. As you were pointing out, in the States, the American Association of Museum Directors has changed its rules so that it is no longer an offence under the organisation's constitution for a museum director to deaccession to obtain money for running costs because of COVID. Mm. COVID's changing everything.
Well, and in that sense, in the case of the Royal Academy, obviously, only 12 years ago now, I suppose, but in the past past decade or so, we've been living with the rumbling on of the credit crunch, the financial crisis of 2007, yes. 2008. In some cases, in some places, it's still really kind of still rippling. The museum has been through that sort of thing, but this is fundamentally different in terms of COVID impact on economics. Interestingly, the piece here says that this Michelangelo statue called Taddeo Tondo is a 515-year-old sculpture and had been given to the London Gallery in 1829 following the death of its previous owner, Lady Margaret Beaumont, as an inspiration to students in the academy's schools. Interestingly, this is actually also connecting back to one of the earlier segments, in so much as this is an act of a relative philanthropy to a public institution by a wealthy donor. I suppose one of the questions is money and should money be such a stranglehold on such institutions that they have to fundamentally undermine their function in society in order to survive and in order to make sure that their employees continue to have gainful employment in the context of a near unprecedented moment in financial history? I would argue not. I would argue that society itself, i.e. taxpayers and the government, should actually should prop up and help institutions like this, because their net benefit to us is probably immeasurable, in so much as if the Royal Academy will continue to exist, and without that statue, it will be poorer for it, culturally poorer for it, if you see what I mean. But then again, I mean, maybe I'm being too much of a liberal, as they might say in the US, or too lefty,
too woke,
lefty do good. There you go. I'm not sure this falls in the category of wokeness, or maybe we are actually falling into is the wrong word. We are finding ourselves as a sector moving towards a new rhythm, a new reality, a more business-like relationship with art and artifacts and the institutions that house them. Where do you see this going, particularly in the UK, in the next couple of months?
I only see it ending badly, sadly. Either way, I think there are profound ethical issues at the moment about selling high end art. There is increasing evidence that the art market is being high end art market is being distorted by a few very large, very well funded museums, particularly in the Gulf, but also by, for want of a better word, dark money that is being laundered through the sale of high-end art. Only this morning there was a story about Freeports on Radio 4 Today, which had been promoted by the British government, and Esther McVeigh, the business secretary, was being directly asked by interviewers on Radio 4 and on Sky about the issues around the use of Freeports for money laundering and the storage of high-end art so that it can be transferred between owners without having to pay taxes. And therefore, basically, somebody can use an artwork like that as a bank without it ever being seen by the public. And so I think for a museum to get into that market now, to be honest, that market stinks to me.
Well, is this how a relatively obscure Egyptian statue can come to be worth £15 million?
£15 million. You might say that, I couldn't possibly comment.
I mean, in the context of a market that's grossly inflated. I don't mean that.
Exactly. No, that's exactly how it works. The allegation is that high-end artifacts are... their values are possibly driven artificially high by the way they're bidded in auctions. So that they're given this nominal value, this paper value, or this value in pixels, actually, which can then be used to trade that artifact effectively as a gambling chip.
Which can be cashed asset.
As an appreciable asset, which can be cashed in at any point or just kept to appreciate in the bank vault. I think I'm right in saying that the most expensive Van Gogh ever hasn't been seen since it was sold in Japan. No one knows if it even still exists.
That is how
unaccountable this market is, and I think for an organisation like the Royal Academy to go and play in that pond, I think really is. It's not acceptable. Ethically, it's not acceptable. I know, saving jobs is really, really important at the moment, but not every organisation can do it. Just yesterday, the RSC announced it was putting around 150 jobs at risk because it can't reopen. It can barely reopen its largest theatre, and it certainly can't reopen its two smallest ones in any kind of viable way. And the Chancellor, yesterday, Rishi Sunak, was caught on camera. He wrote back on this later, but implying, for example, that people in the arts and culture who were losing their jobs could go and retrain and do something else, because not everybody's going to have a job at the end of COVID.
And that's... in that sense, that is very pertinent in so much as that's heavily implied in an awful lot of the rhetoric coming out of government at the moment, is that basically, as far as they're concerned, they are redefining what is being called a viable job. And for the most part, viable jobs are conventional office jobs. And they're not necessarily, frankly, people like you and me.
No, that's absolutely correct.
And yeah, I mean, hopefully we can continue to find a way to be viable. But the thing is, though, thankfully, we don't have the overheads of, for example, the Royal Academy or big theatres in London.
But again, don't forget, I mean, I don't know what the state of the Royal Academy is in terms of the ownership of its site. Obviously, it's in a prime site in the West End, just off Piccadilly. Surrounded by high-end art galleries and so on. So, you know, it pays London premiums on everything. Now, again, nobody's going to suggest that it moves out of Burlington House and sells that for redevelopment as a hotel or something.
No.
Because that would be an equally big cultural loss.
Mm.
And it's also clear that this problem, particularly again at the Royal Academy, is pre-COVID. It was already in the organisation was already in financial difficulties before COVID.
Mm-hmm.
But it's there is no easy solution to any of this. Like you,
I've got an easy solution.
What's that?
We all acknowledge.
Don't eat bats.
Sorry.
Don't eat bats, even don't, in Halloween. In
well, yes, well, yes. Don't eat bats or mongoose or whatever. But no. In all seriousness, well, this is a serious but also jokey, tongue-in-cheek solution. We acknowledge as a species that money is a human invention. We acknowledge that we have all globally undergone a tremendous economic trauma, and maybe we give each other a bit of a break, as opposed to insisting that the old rules apply to this sort of problem. Now, the thing is, one could have said that about the 1926 crash. I recognize that. I get it. But it's just a shame that we're having to make these sorts of choices as society. You know, these are social, cultural choices about the value that we place on the fabric of society, as opposed to simply an office job or the turnover of a bank. And chancellors, this is actually where I do agree with the chancellors, that yesterday he was implying, he said publicly rather, that there are some things that go beyond government, in so much as he was trying to make the argument that actually basically government can't keep on paying your wages, thank you very much, so you need to get a more viable job. But actually, I think
this isn't actually true according to some other political theories. But anyway, that's another story.
Well, true. But in another way, I think it's probably correct that actually government shouldn't be defining. It's not government's role to define what is important to society. It's their role to serve society. And at the moment, it feels a little bit as though we're having this sort of thing forced down our throats, these sort of choices. You know, you guys, yeah. you arty-farty types, you historical types, you cultural types, you aren't viable. That's, again, we're going back to that word. You aren't profitable. You aren't the future. And I don't quite see what the future of that sort of thinking is.
Look, let's face it, there's no logic in any of this, because the government has dismissed it, but from being a fringe possibility that was being trialled in a few parts of the world 18 months ago, the concept of, for example, universal basic income replacing the welfare and benefits has become a serious discussion point.
Yeah.
In even Western countries with a largely capitalist economy,
mm-hmm.
free market economy. I jokingly might point out that in the Star Trek universe they can build astronomically expensive starships, but it's stated a number of times in Star Trek, the Federation of Planets has gone beyond the concept of money, and people have just given what they need.
Well, except that's not the case in Picard. I don't know if you saw Picard, but they've absolutely rolled back on that sort of stuff. As far as I'm concerned,
I wonder why.
Yeah, well, indeed, it's art reflecting life, I guess. But yeah, Picard's vision is far less than that wonderful vision that he lays out in a couple of sentences in First Contact, I believe. So now we're back to geeky movies again.
like I say, art reflecting life and vice versa.
Yeah, yeah.
But no, I think these are ongoing discussions, and at the moment everything's up for grabs. You have had a Conservative Chancellor being more socialist than any socialist Chancellor has ever been in the UK.
Mm.
Except they're now rowing back on that quite severely.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, this same government is prepared to tank part of the economy, culture and hospitality, which generates eight times more income than it gains in support.
Mm.
I think it's something like that. It's a massive net contributor to the UK economy. It's prepared to tank that to defend fishing rights, which are largely owned by foreign companies, as part of the Brexit negotiations. You know, there's no coherence to the arguments.
Well, and also to preserve, to prop up house prices, for example, we heard yesterday as well, and also to help people in the city, to help the financial markets, and again, once you start talking about that, then it's difficult for people not to go, oh, you're being a lefty. Again, it's not this is literally what is happening. I'm describing what is happening. I'm not. This isn't a conspiracy. And just to bring this back to the point of this segment, those decisions have genuine real world implications for example, the literal stuff of institutions as grand as the Royal Academy. You know, it's a genuine shame.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll finish it on a light and very cynical note. There was the joke that was doing the rounds when it seems like years ago, months ago, it was only a matter of about 6 weeks ago, the government was telling us all to go back to work again, and the government's fatuous idea for three clause slogans or three word slogans was being satirized by the idea that it was referring to a well-known sandwich chain or chain of sandwich shops which are highly represented in city centers, and the joke I think it was something like go to work, save Pret, kill your gran.
okay. But yes, yeah. I mean, the priorities of this government are interesting, certainly for archaeologists to observe, definitely.
And infinitely variable, depending on what the current pressure, which direction the current pressure is coming from.
Yeah, U-turn city.